Live from downtown Detroit, Local 4 News at 5 starts now.
With just 2 weeks to go before the trial, attorneys for James Crumbly make a major request. They say the Oxford school shooter's texts and journal should not be allowed as evidence for the jury. James Crumbly's defense attorney using a new tactic in hopes of keeping her client from avoiding the guilty verdict that landed on his wife, Jennifer.
A jury found her guilty of 4 counts of involuntary manslaughter, and she's awaiting her sentencing in the case on April 9th. James Crumbly's trial starts March 5th, and there are numerous motions attempting to prevent evidence from getting before the jury. Rod Maloney was in court for this morning's hearing. Rod, somehow the big news, though, happened outside the courtroom.
Well, and in fact, it just happened a few moments ago where Judge Cheryl Matthews went ahead and agreed to allow the defense to have what they call more peremptory challenges. That's when they go to seat jurors. If the defense doesn't like that particular juror's answer, they can keep them from being in the jury pool. That just came out. But then there's also this from last night, which you've already talked about, and that is to try and keep the journals and the texts out of the case. That's not heard today. There was another motion heard today. Let's find out about that.
47-year-old James Crumbly entered the courtroom accompanied by the usual high security. Unusual was the sight of his lawyer, Mario Lehman, placing headphones on him to better hear the proceedings. At issue, whether 3 students involved in the shooting could testify. Assistant Prosecutor Mark Feast telling Judge Cheryl Matthews he actually is only interested in the testimony of 2 former students to augment the silent security video of that shooting that the judge already allowed into evidence.
So these are the 2 individuals that have the best perspective, who are now above the age of 18, who can actually testify as to what they saw, what they felt, what they heard as the shooter emerged from the bathroom and opened fire.
Keast adding the other student is under 18 and now not needed considering the emotions involved. Yet it's exactly those raw feelings why the students should not testify, says Mario Lehman, James Crumbly's attorney.
The primary purpose of their testimony is to inflame the emotions of the jury. I mean, their testimony or whatever they can provide can also be provided in a video. The whole purpose of admitting the video and not having sound on the video was to lessen the prejudicial impact on the jury.
Judge Matthews didn't immediately rule on that question, but did allow the Oxford man, who previously owned the gun used in the shooting, to testify.
I was sort of racking my brain to see why he's relevant, but now I think he is.
Now, what the point there that the prosecution put in is that that man knows about a gun lock that was sold with the gun when he sold it back to the Oxford gun store, the store that the Crumblies went and bought that gun from. So she is going to allow that testimony, and we'll hear more about that in the days to come. Back to you.
Rod, is the defense still asking for a change of venue in this case?
Indeed they are. It's another one of the flurry of motions that they put out there, and in fact that's going to be a part of a hearing. All of the information, or most of the information that you heard talking about the texts and the journal and also the change of venue, is going to be taken up in a hearing next week right here at the courthouse.
And we'll be following it. Okay, Rod, we appreciate it. And as the trial for James Crumbly approaches, we're going to be streaming every minute of the proceedings live on Local 4 Plus. We'll also have exclusive analysis and daily recaps of everything that happened. Again, the trial is set to get underway March 5th.
All right, let's get to breaking news now that we are following right now from Richmond in northern Macomb County. Crews there battling a house fire. And as you can see, this looks like it is going to be a total loss.
This is happening along 33-mile road and Armada Ridge Road. No word yet on what may have caused it, but you can see there from this video from Sky 4, crews were busy working to put out any hot spots.
Recovery crews were busy late this afternoon in Warren after an accident at a building demolition site. We've got video from Sky 4 over Van Dyke and Warren, not too far from 8 Mile. You see that backhoe there tipped over on the site. We've got a number of calls in to get information on exactly how all this came about, but you can see there were a number of cranes brought in to try to get it back on its tracks. No word on any injuries.
Also here at 5, 2 Republican operatives who led the fundraising effort for the Unlock Michigan petition are charged with campaign finance violations and perjury.
It was that campaign that ended Governor Whitmer's emergency powers during the COVID pandemic, you'll recall. Mara McDonald live outside Michigan Attorney General Dana Nessel's office in the News Center area. Mara, both women charged today, pretty well known in Lansing circles.
Devin, they sure are, and highly capable fundraisers, and it is in that capacity that these women find themselves in real hot water with the AG. Let me show everybody.
Let me take you back to the height of the pandemic. The governor was using a 1945 Emergency Powers Act to make sweeping health and safety restrictions that shut down schools, businesses, and life as we all knew it. Well, there was pushback by both the then Republican-led legislature and the public. An effort to repeal Whitmer's powers was started, called Unlock Michigan, and it was successful. They gathered more than 460,000 signatures, and the legislature, along partisan lines, voted to enact the ballot initiative, which repealed her powers. Now, fast forward to today. What the AG is saying happened is that fundraising for this effort was shady and done to conceal who was donating and how much. Nessel is charging Heather Lombardini. She is a well-known Lansing fundraiser. Nessel says she took in money for the effort and failed to follow campaign finance laws. Sandy Baxter, another well-known fundraiser tied to the effort, has been charged with perjury for allegedly lying to the AG's investigators. Both women, according to Nessel, coordinated with then-Senate Majority Leader Mike Shirky to funnel so-called dark money into the Unlock Michigan effort. Shirky, however, isn't being charged with anything. Nessel says this illustrates how our campaign finance laws need to be overhauled.
Without these hired guns, these dark money operations would never exist. And I'd argue that they are even sought after and hired for that exact skill set. And in this instance, these hired guns also lied to government officials to hide their wrongdoings, literally making the cover-up worse than the crime.
Back here live, important to point out that the misdemeanors against Lombardini in this case, those are for campaign finance violations. The felonies against both women, well, those are for allegedly lying after the fact. We're live in the news center tonight at the AG's office. I'm Mara McDonald, Local 4.
All right, thanks, Mara.
Well, we got a first look at the work being done to construct Detroit's own version of the Hollywood sign for the upcoming NFL draft. This sign will be put up along I-94 between Wyoming and Central, and similar signs will be going up in several other locations around the city. Officials say the project is all about sending a strong message to Detroit's visitors.
And it's just a reminder that Detroit is, we're coming back, you know, we're on the map. And we want Detroiters to understand that and feel that, and then also the visitors as they come into Detroit. They will know that they're coming into the city limits.
There's no date right now when the signs will be completed, but officials say all work should be done by April 25th. That, of course, is the first day of the draft. We'll have a full report on this project coming up later tonight on Local 4 News at 6.
From a campaign trail to Capitol Hill, presidential politics heating up. Donald Trump and Nikki Haley throwing punches as she fights to stay in the race. President Biden promising new sanctions against Russia as his brother James Biden is questioned by House Republicans.
The president is on the campaign trail in California while his brother is on the hot seat in Washington. House Republicans question James Biden behind closed doors today as part of their impeachment inquiry into the president, an inquiry Democrat Jamie Raskin says is baseless.
It's been a wild goose chase built on conspiracy theory and lies from the beginning.
Even less credible now, Raskin says, because yesterday, a former FBI informant named Alexander Smirnov was charged with providing false information about the Biden family during the 2020 election. False information, prosecutors claim, that came from Russian intelligence officials. Russia, again a topic on the Republican campaign trail, where the former president compared himself to Alexei Navalny, the Putin opponent who died in prison 5 days ago.
Navalny is a very sad situation. It's a horrible thing, but it's happening in our country too. We are turning into a communist country in many ways.
Nikki Haley today calling out Trump for not using his town hall to condemn Vladimir Putin and trying to position herself to voters as the best option in the race for the White House.
70% of Americans don't want a Trump-Biden rematch. They're the two most disliked politicians in America.
Though Trump remains ahead of Nikki Haley in the polls, nearly 2-1, with less than 3 days until the primary in Haley's home state.
Yeah, the South Carolina primary is on Saturday, but we're also watching for news coming Friday when the White House is expected to announce new sanctions against Russia. All right, let's turn to the weather now with pleasure. because look at the live look from our downtown sky cam. What are they?
Yeah, the sun's been shining off and on all day. Big story, though, temperatures. Let's get over to Kim Adams and a first look at what's turned out to be a balmy forecast, at least by February standards.
Right? Yeah, no kidding. We made it to 61 at Metro Airport. The record was 63, but close enough. What happened today, we were expected to be more in the upper 50s, which is where we are now, but we got just enough sunshine breaking through the clouds that we did warm up quite nicely. 60 downtown, dropping back to the upper 50s at Metro Airport, 58 in Pontiac, 54 in Mount Clemens, and mid-50s in Port Huron. We are much warmer than we were yesterday by about 10 to even 15 degrees in some spots. 13 degrees warmer right now than it was just 24 hours ago in Pontiac, and 14 degrees warmer at the airport, 17 down in Monroe. We've had a few showers up into the thumb and a couple sprinkles here and there, but for the most part, it's been dry here in Metro Detroit. Tomorrow, we expect a little bit more in the way of rain, especially south of Metro Detroit, as our high climbs back to 50. We'll talk about a cold snap followed by even more temps in the 60s. We'll do that in a few minutes.
All right, Kim.